know that as a Christian, because of the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we know that we can walk consistently unto the Lord, by which that is our topic, that is the message that I'm going to deliver this morning, the consistent walk of a believer. And you will remember that the epistles were written to genuine people. Of course, we're talking about people who were experiencing genuine problems in the real world, you see? And, of course, when we talk about their world, even our world. Because we know that their world, as well as our world, was hostile to their Christian faith. There are at least some reasons why Paul wrote these epistles or these letters to the church at Thessalonica. Of course, number one is to assure them of Paul's condition, to assure them of his love and concern. And number two, to encourage them that they could live holy living. Of course, we know with the help of the Lord. And number three, to ground them in their doctrines, in their faith, especially in the doctrines of the second coming. You remember that 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 mentions on the second coming. And he also mentioned, based on verse 9, that we are not appointed to wrath, but what? But to obtain salvation in Christ Jesus. And not only that, but to check and straighten some weaknesses in the church. I know that is exactly what we need today. And as we listen to this message, Paul speaks to us about how should we live in this world in the light of the Christ's return soon. Three things that we need to consider. Be circumspect. And then be conscious. And then be careful as we worship the Lord. Of course, in our Sunday school, we discuss about the lessons on worship. There is a prescribed, there is a proper way where the Lord gave on how to worship the Lord. But this point of time, as a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ, there is a question that are we living in a consistent life as a Christian? So to do that, it is important for us to understand, based on verses 1 to 11, that we should be circumspect. We know that there are many contrasts between the lives of the believers as well as the unbelievers. And a few of those are brought out in this passage, in the scriptures that we just read earlier. Of course, when we talk about light and darkness, as far as the world is concerned, the coming of the Lord will be like what? A thief in the night. Right? The unbeliever is in the dark because their understanding is darkened. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 18 says, having the understanding darkened, being alienated, being turned away from where? From the life, God, life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness. You know, there are a lot of things why unbeliever remain unbeliever. Why unbeliever remain in their unbelief is because of their blindness to the truth. You see, and they remain in that standing because they love the darkness. They love the darkness that is being controlled by the power of darkness and is headed for eternal darkness. Because they love darkness, of course, they are headed there. Sadly, they were living in a temporary life here on earth. They live in darkness. Then it goes continually. When they die, they will be headed for eternal darkness. Unless the gospel of light will bring unto them, come unto them, and receive them, and then we know that they would escape from that blindness and from that darkness. But the believer, according to verse 5, but the believer is a child of light and therefore should live in the light ready for Christ's coming. Amen? Here we could find in verse 5, ng 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says, ye are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of night nor of darkness. Oh, thank God, because you could see everything. You could see the beauty when it is in the light. You could see the beauty of God's creation. But when you are in darkness, you could not see it clearly. When you are in the light, you could see the hope. And you could see the reality of our destiny. Now, brethren, not only light and darkness, but expectancy and surprise. The whole world, or the unsaved world, lives in false security. They thought that having money, having riches, having big houses or homes, or having bank accounts, or having sabi natin earthly security, they are safe. Brethren, they are living the world, the unsaved world, lives in a false security. They are just like those on the unsinkable. You know yung movie na Titanic, right? Titanic. When the Coast Guard wired the Titanic, several iceberg warnings. The radio men, they were wired, meaning to say they were cold, that they are facing ahead of them iceberg. You know, they have given the warning that they are in danger, but they ignored it. The radio men ignored them, and they finally responded with, don't bother me, I'm too busy. That's what the world, that's what the unsaved are doing in our time today. They love the world. You know what happened to the Titanic? Less than an hour later, the Titanic was sinking. Now the same principles apply for those friends of ours, for those loved ones of ours, if they just only listen, understanding upon helping them on how to come out from that standing. If they will only listen to the message we share, to the message we preach, to the message we tell them, they will never perish into eternal darkness. You see, the tragedy could have been avoided if they had only listened to the messages. Remember that Paul gives two illustrations of Christ's coming. The thief shows the surprise of his coming. Notice here in verses 3 and 4, says, "For when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman," tama ba binabasa ko? Yeah. "As travail upon woman with child, and they shall not escape." Verse 4. "But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day should overtake you as a thief." The thief shows the surprise of his coming. No thieves would come to your house telling you or give you a warning and go to your house and rob all your jewelries, all your riches. They would not tell them. The woman giving birth shows the suddenness and suffering involved. You see, when Jesus returns and take away his people, then the suffering of the tribulation will begin, which we call the day of the Lord. You know, I always thank God in this position, the reason why we will be taken, because Christians were not appointed unto wrath. Amen. Brethren, the expectancy and surprise. We could also see here the soberness and drunkenness. Christians who are looking for Christ to come will stay awake and alert. Amen. It is a sad situation when a Christian allows himself to be drunk with the affairs of this world. Notice that in verses 6 to 7, "Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober." Verse 7 says, "For they that sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night." Christian, don't be in a sad situation that we as Christians be drunk in the affairs of this world. The unsaved of this world are like drunken men, living in a false paradise and enjoying a false security. Right? Ang safety kasi nila. They thought they are already in paradise because of their riches, because of their position, because of their possession, because of what they enjoy. Sadly, anything that they enjoyed in this life is temporary. And Christians, it is our responsibility to warn them. It's our obligation. Kaya nga, debtor tayo. We are becoming debtor of the gospel. After our salvation, like Apostle Paul says, "I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarian, both to the wise and to the unwise." Because of that position, he said, they need to be enlightened, they need to be brought, they need to hear the message. And he said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation." You see, we will not be ashamed, because the message we're bringing, we brought to the people, are the message of eternity. the message of salvation. Now listen, but for every drunk, there is hangover, a time when they must pay the consequences of their brief escape from reality. Christian, not only soberness and drunkenness, but salvation and wrath. John chapter 3 verse 36 says, "He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him." Brethren, but God hath not appointed us to wrath. I like that. As verse 9 says, we will no longer see this day when the wrath of God will be poured out into this world. The wrath of God will fall upon the unbeliever, but the Christian has salvation of deliverance through our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice our salvation isn't dependent on what we do. Amen? Our salvation isn't dependent on what we do, but upon what Christ did. Amen. What Christ did. He died for us. Amen. He died for me. Whether we wake or sleep, there is a reason to be comforted and comfort others. Amen. Well, I am very much comforted with what the Lord has done for my life. And He saves me and changes me. Yeah, I like the song, after getting to know the Lord Jesus Christ after salvation, we believe that God keeps changing me. Amen. Keep changing me. My Savior Jesus. Sabi niya, I'm not the same perfect that I used to be. Because we believe that the one, the person who saves you and changes you, and as we go, follow the Lord's footstep, He will keep us in the status of changing. Christian, we need to be circumspect. And another thing, we need to be conscious. Of course, when we're talking about circumspect, it means it's like watching. Amen? Here comes now, be conscious. Of course, it involves our mind. In verses 12 to 16, here we could see that, "And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for the own sake, and be at peace among yourselves." Verse 14. "Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that unruly, comport the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good both among yourselves and to all men. Rejoice evermore." Christian, be conscious first toward whom? Toward leadership. The church family needs spiritual leadership, because without leadership, the family can fall apart. God ordained leadership for the church and for the local church. Therefore, there are certain responsibility that the church family have. Of course, our responsibility is to accept them in the Lord, to appreciate them for their work among the family, and to love them as brothers, of course, and to obey as leader. We know that the result of the church family following their spiritual leaders will give will bring unity or peace and harmony in the church. You see, so be conscious. As verse 12, sabi niya, we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you. Remember them. Sabi niya, admonish over you in the Lord and admonish you. And he said in verse 13, and to esteem them very highly in the love for their work, sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Thank God that God is sending leader to oversee, to overlook. He is preparing something for individual to be strong and to enjoy their services unto the Lord. Now listen, we should be conscious toward this thing, toward the spiritual leadership, and not only that, toward one another. In the verses, as we continue from verses 14 to 16, we could see the exhortation. Merong mga warning. It is not toward another. See, we should be conscious toward our leader and toward one another. It is not enough to have such leadership. There must also be a partnership with its member doing their part. Tama? United we stand, divided we fall. Paul points out some particular kinds of Christian who need the help of others. Sino yung mga kailangan? The unruly. You know, you cannot sometimes realize that many times in the church there are people that are unruly. The unruly, they are careless, who need to be warned when they get out of line. They need to be warned. Not only the unruly, but the people-minded, the Bible says, following verses 14 to 16, this term has nothing to do with mentality. It actually means the faint-hearted, the people-minded. They are ones who are first to give up and quit, and they need to be lifted up. Amen? They need to be motivated and they need to be encouraged. Sabi ng Bible, we need to encourage one another. Toward one another. Be conscious toward leader, toward one another. Notice here, under that is, who are those? We need to consider the unruly, the people-minded, and another thing, the weak. They are those who are not mature in the Lord. They need to be helped and supported until they can walk in the Lord. Especially those young Christian. Amen. When they are young, they need our watch. And we need to watch over them until they could stand. Our ministry towards them needs to be patient and in proper attitude. Now, as we go to our last point, be careful as we worship. In verses 17 to 28, we could see that worship is the most important activity of the local church family. It is the most important thing. We see here the elements that make up the worship ministry of a church. Ano po yung mga ministry? Prayer, praise, preaching of the word, and then purifying attitude. Those are the elements that is necessary Notice that in verse 17, here we could find, ano sabi sa verse 17? Pray without ceasing. Amen. Pray without ceasing. That's why what we're doing as a Christian, rain or shine, we go to the intended place where we could bend our knees, we could kneel down before the Lord, and pray to God. Praying for those unsaved, praying for those needs, praying for one another, praying for those prospects, praying for those projects, praying for those missions, praying for those who are in need of prayer. Be careful as we worship. And one of the elements in our worship is prayer. And we give importance on prayer because we believe in the power of prayer. Amen? Prayer changes people, not things. Now listen. Ang sabi nga, a prayerful Christian is a powerful Christian. Prayer was an important part of worship in early church. That's why here in Thessalonica, they were taught that they had to pray without ceasing. It refers to an attitude and relationship with God. Now listen, we need to continually keep the prayer lines open with God. Amen? We need. Kung maaari, pag nakipag-chat nga tayo, you want to see the signals, yung caller, alam mo kapag naka-internet or not. You want that open. Pag naman sa mga video, you don't want to close it. But in the line of God, we need to continually keep the prayer lines open with God. We should always be in proper fellowship with the Father so that we can speak freely with Him at any time. Amen. Now what hindered for the cuts of that line? Sin, disobedience, wickedness. Ang sabi ng Bible, if I regard iniquity, that is sin, in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. You see, we see here the elements that make the worship ministry of a church: prayer. Verse 18, praise. Of course, in praise, it involves thanksgiving. Amen? Tignan niyo po yung verse 18. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Thanksgiving is also a vital part of worship. Dapat ganun tayo. Even in times of trials, you can sing the song, I thank you, Lord, for the trials that comes my way. In that way I can go each day. I thank you, Lord, for the patience those trials bring. In the process of growing, I can learn to care. Brethren, thanksgiving is also a vital part of worship. The Bible says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God. When we fail to be careful to thank God for everything, we grow ungrateful. Amen. It is wonderful when we receive some great blessing from God, but it is just wonderful to know that He gives us all the little seemingly insignificant things each day. If we win, constantly remind ourselves of His goodness by thanking Him. Amen? Salamat, Panginoon. Thank you, Lord, for everything. And it will help us also to be a blessing to others. And third element is preaching. The three exhortations in this verse go together and help us understand how the how the Holy Spirit works in Christian worship. Notice that in verse 91, quench not the Spirit. There are times in our life, as we listen to the message of the Word of God, there are some input that's very touching, and you really sincerely receive it. Don't ignore it. The Bible says, quench not the Holy Spirit. There can be emotion, commotion, but unless there is spiritual truth, the Holy Spirit will not work. This is what we do. We must allow the Holy Spirit to teach us, and we must the Holy Word of God to teach us. When we have both taking place, then we can prove all things. Amen. So preaching, importante to in the element of worship. Amen. And thank God. You know, we're the nucleus of the church. We are, sabihin na natin yung numbers natin, talagang totoong worshipers. And most, sabihin na pa natin, they become nominal Christian because you could just see them not consistently. But brethren, when we have both the Word and the Holy Spirit, I tell you, when we have both taking place, then we can prove all things. Okay, as the Word preaches, tick, the Holy Spirit works, gives conviction. You see, importante po yun. And the number last, yung purified attitudes. In verses 22 to 24, abstain. Kaya nga purified eh. Diba? Parang yung tubig na dumadaan, sinasala from the filter to make it clean. Ganun din ang buhay natin. The purpose of worship is that we might become like Christ. From the worship service, as we as sinners, as we listen to the message of God's word, dito niya tayo nililinis. The Lord is purifying us as a Christian. The Lord is molding us into the kind of life that pleases the Lord. To be like Jesus Christ. That is the goal of that worship. So the purpose of worship is that we might become like Christ in character and conduct. Purified attitude is more than just a negative aspect. Abstain from all appearance of evil. It is seen through balance of negative and positive. It isn't enough that we abstain from evil. We must be sanctified unto God for service. Amen? Not just only abstain. Kinakailangan masanctify tayo. Amen? It means we need to be purified by the Word of God. Ito yung cleansing natin. Amen? You see, and sometimes you do not miss your text, you do not miss the books that you are reading, but you miss a lot of time the Bible. You see? Purified attitude. And of course, fellowship is also important. In verses 25 to 28, this one aspect of worship that cannot be overlooked. Dito kasi, sa fellowship natin, we could see perfection is important. And it could only happen when there is a strong fellowship. Praying for one another, loving one another, and sharing the Word of God with one another is a vital to our growth as a Christian. Christian, our walk as a believer is important, not only to us, but to others as well. We are epistles. Para tayo mga libro. We are book. Sabihin na natin. We are like a living book, read, sabi na natin, of all men. And it is important that we watch how to walk in this present world that we might not bring reproach upon Christ. We must be circumspect. We must be conscious. And then we must be careful. Those things are important to lead a consistent life as a believer. May the Lord God bless our hearts. I am praying that the message reaches our need and touches us to be more committed unto the Lord. Let us pray.